Since Nevada legalized casino gaming back in 1931, Las Vegas has been the ultimate destination for high rollers willing to risk it all for the promise of big returns. But shifting tastes and trends required the city to evolve, which it has, deliciously. Jamie Wax has the story of how Vegas has gone from gambling mecca to food heaven. Jamie, you got the assignment of a life.
Yet again, Michelle, you're right. Good morning. It used to be that gaming made up the vast majority of revenue at Las Vegas' resorts and casinos, but gambling now represents less than half of the money that is brought in. That's in large part due to visitors spending less time at the card tables and more time at the dining tables.
13 years ago, when you started here at Caesars, could you imagine someone telling you that gaming would no longer be the primary source of revenue for the city of Las Vegas?
Short answer is no.
Caesars Palace Regional President Gary Selesner says he's seen an unexpected shift over the last decade.
We began to see younger and more diversified groups of people arriving in Las Vegas with different aspirations with what to do with their vacation. And it turned out that one of the key drivers for many of these people became food.
It's a huge reversal of fortune for a city used to giving away meals to attract gamblers.
Those look delicious.
But even before that change, there were the culinary pioneers of Vegas, like respected restaurateur and author of the best-selling cookbook, Honey Salt, Las Vegas-based Elizabeth Blau.
You have been called the chef snatcher for how good you are at grabbing celebrity chefs and convincing them to do things.
You know, it all started with Bellagio. Originally, when I did the deals for Le Cirque and Osteria del Circo, the idea was those were gonna be the, you know, the only two restaurants. But with more than 26 outlets in the hotel, it was clear that there was room for more, and it was an exciting time.
Blau echoes what many in Las Vegas told us. Things began to change because of one celebrity chef who was an early adapter.
But it was really Wolfgang Puck who, you know, was that pioneer, and he was the one that, you know, kind of really made everybody, you know, stand on edge and say, like, look, people are not just looking for a free meal in the casino. I think that was really the big impetus for change.
What was it about Las Vegas that you saw?
Well, I loved Las Vegas not because of gambling, but because of boxing. Each time when we went, we said, where are we going to go eat? There was no place to eat.
He took a gamble and opened Spago Las Vegas in late 1992. Which at first didn't appear to pay off.
So I said, oh my God, I made the biggest mistake in my life opening in Las Vegas. There's nobody there. We got a great review. That night we had maybe 60 customers. Then came New Year's, was like an explosion. Customers everywhere standing in line outside from the restaurant, and all of a sudden business went like from 0 to 100.
That concept of 0 to 100 sums up what really matters in Vegas. The numbers, and it took a numbers man to convince the major players to go all in.
You know, when I first started doing business in Las Vegas, it really was all about, you know, just the buffet, and it was really a loss leader.
Damian McGovero is the author of the Underground Culinary Tour and the creator of the hospitality software now used by the majority of restaurants on the Strip. He led us on a culinary tour of our own, including a stunning dinner at Nobu.
You know, you had 6 dates back 25 years ago that offered casinos. Now 90% of the United States, because no one wants to lose the tax revenue. And that really made casinos more of a commodity. And Las Vegas understood this trend and knew they had to diversify away from just being gaming.
That meant stepping up the game in innovation in more ways than just restaurants, including custom hotel experiences like the one offered by the Four Seasons, tucked away from the gaming action, but connected to the mammoth Mandalay Bay Casino Resort by a secret door.
This is a part of a bigger trend in hospitality called a hotel within a hotel.
That trend allowed us to go beyond just dinner at Nobu with an exclusive breakfast at the first Nobu Hotel, hidden away inside Caesar's Palace, which we followed up with a casino buffet lunch. Let's just say the experience offered today doesn't quite fit the old stereotype.
We created a design that when you walk into the buffet, you have to go wow, because it's not like, you know, your grandfather's buffet. Everything is done at the very highest level.
We finished our full day of eating with an elaborate dinner at Wolfgang Puck's Spago and its new home above the fountains of the Bellagio, The increase in quality goes beyond the dinner hour. High-end cocktail programs have come to Vegas in full force, as we experienced at the bars of the Venetian and Palazzo, and at massive DJ-driven nightclubs like Omnia. But keeping the quality high at Las Vegas Volume is no small task.
How many bartenders do you have trying to reinterpret your very complex cocktail?
Well, that's an interesting dynamic, you know, with over 20 outlets, hundreds and hundreds of bartenders, you know, so managing that level of high-end execution and consistency is key.
Andrew Pollard oversees the beverage program at Wynn Properties.
We have 40 million people coming through town every single year, so it's a pretty big bullseye to hit and to try to navigate, but for us, it's about creating that experience, especially as we do have so many returning customers.
And as the competition for high-end food and entertainment in Las Vegas continues to grow, the man who was there when there was no competition says,
et voilà.
It's a good thing.
Everywhere you look, there's a new restaurant with a famous chef that's opening up. What does that make you feel?
I'm actually really excited, especially about Las Vegas, that we were the first and we had so many followers. I feel like, you know, I was there and they all followed me. I was the shepherd and I had all the sheep coming with me.
And now you got quite a flock.
Now I have a big flock, yeah. And this is big competition now, so we have to keep on our toes. Competition is good. But, you know, you have always to work on it. You always have to try to get better in hospitality and in cooking.
I tell you, that was a tough gig.
Yeah.
I'm really sorry you had that assignment. I want one of those drinks that came out of that smoky box.
Yes. Now, that is, I believe that drink is about $50 to $60.
I don't care. I want
one. The high-end areas of the Wynn properties. But that was, I will tell you, the cocktail I had was the best old-fashioned I ever drank in my life.
I mean, they have the money to spend, a lot of people, when they're in Vegas, so it just makes sense.
It
just took a while.
It does. And, I mean, it is a real shift, and it's bringing in other chefs, like Giada De Laurentiis has a fast casual place and a coffee place. Daniel Hume, who I know you love.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Has Nomad
Road
bar
trip. Road trip. Road trip. Road trip.